everybody. This is Grant Kemp from CreativeCashflow.com. Today I want to talk about some of the talking points that you're going to need to discuss whenever you're dealing with a wraparound buyer. And again, you know, this is going to be, hey, we've got a house with underlying debt on it, whatever that might be, whether that we bought sub two, or it's debt that we got from a bank that we financed, or whatever it is. When you've got debt and you're selling it on a wraparound to your end buyer, what are some of the things that you need to discuss with them? Before we really go in too much on this, and one of the big things that I really want to stress is that the most important thing that you can do is ask for questions. The most important thing that you can do is really stress to them that you want them to understand what's going on, that they get the ins and outs of this. I think it's very important because a lot of times people don't understand that this is a really complicated subject, right? You're having to watch an entire video series on how to do this, and you're an investor. You're already in this world. You already understand what's going on with investing and owner financing, that kind of stuff. This may be the first house that this person ever bought. They have no idea what's going on with this. They don't understand a lot of even the principles that you understand, right? So we need to ensure that they don't have any lingering questions because we want them to be comfortable with the decision that they've made to move forward with you as your buyer for this property. They're gonna put a lot of money down. They're gonna be paying you a lot of money every month. You really wanna make sure that you're making them feel comfortable with their decision. Also, by asking a lot of questions about their questions, it really helps them to understand that the ball is in their court as far as making sure that they get what's going on with that, because we're not gonna be responsible for them not understanding something if we've done everything that we can to help them understand. And it does, it just makes you look good. A lot of times when you're getting into situations like this, and you may have experienced this with a car salesman or something like that, people want to glaze through, you know, questions that you might have, and, oh, don't worry about that. We'll just go ahead and sign here. And it makes you feel really uncomfortable and uneasy about that transaction. So we want to avoid that feeling, and by really stressing that we want them to understand it, giving them the opportunity to ask their questions, it does. It makes you look good, and that's what we want. We do want to look good. Let's talk about earnest money a little bit. Earnest money, we always make earnest money non-refundable. Earnest money is a non-refundable price of getting into this contract. So what I do is I make my earnest money $1,500, something along those lines, and it's non-refundable. The only refund that they're gonna get from that earnest money is if we determine that we're not going to approve them and move forward with that contract. But I don't want people wasting my time. With owner financing, one of the nice advantages that we have is that there are so many buyers ready to buy these houses that we've got them. I mean, they're essentially knocking the door down. Now, sometimes it's gonna take longer than other times. And this, you know, I'm not trying to act like this is some miracle solution where you're gonna have every house of yours sold within a day and a half. That's not what it is. But there are a lot of people that have the desire to move forward with this. And you are dealing with a clientele of people that typically doesn't have credit. Otherwise, they would go get a loan from a bank. So we want them committed. We want them in the deal, right? So when they sign that contract, they're gonna give $1,000, $1,500, whatever that might be, and that is a non-refundable earnest money so that if they back out, you get to keep that amount of money for them basically wasting your time to move forward with the contract. Again, it's typically at least $1,000, kind of determine from your standpoint what you wanna see your earnest money be, but that's standard. $1,000, $1,500, something along those lines. We're then gonna explain to them about the third parties that we're using in this transaction. We're gonna be using an attorney, we're gonna be using a servicer, and those are protecting not only us, but protecting them. We want them to understand that, hey, we're doing everything above board. There's a lot of investors out there who are gonna have you sign a piece of paper on the back of a trunk that says that you're gonna owe them money for however long at whatever interest rate, and that's not what we're doing. The way that we're doing things, we're doing everything with an attorney. We're going through a third-party loan servicer so that you've got a licensed and bonded person, a company that you're making your payments to. You're not even making your payments to me. You're making your payments to a licensed and bonded third-party servicer, and that's gonna be who you can make calls to and ask questions to and all that kind of stuff. We've got these things that are here to protect you. Now, for those of you who might be a little bit more advanced and going through my advanced series and figuring out how to do some more things about staffing, that kind of stuff, like, for instance, I don't use a third-party servicer anymore. I have staff in-house that services our notes because you can still charge a servicing fee. That servicing fee is typically $35, maybe even $50 a month. And after you have 20, 30 properties, that's enough to pay for a staff member. And I'll tell you right now that servicing that 20, 30 properties does not take an entire month to worth of work to service it. So you've got your buyers paying a servicing fee that goes towards your staff's pay. That's going to be what pays your staff for you. But you're able to use them as administrative help. They can answer phones, they can make copies, they can do all the closing paperwork, that kind of stuff. So that's something to look forward to in the long run. But as you're getting started and before you have that larger portfolio, something that you're able to start affording a staff and office space and that kind of stuff, using that third party servicer is what you want to do. And again, stressing to your buyer that this is going to protect them is very helpful for this because, like I mentioned a second ago, there are a lot of investors that do just literally pull out some pieces of paper, sign them on the trunk of a car and say, okay, it's your house now, you better pay me your money. And a lot of times they're getting stuff wrong with that. And that scares buyers, and it should scare buyers. And the buyers that aren't scared about it probably haven't thought about it, but we need to stress that we're doing everything in our power to make sure that they're protected. The RMLO process. RMLO, Residential Mortgage Loan Originator, this all has to do with Dodd-Frank. You know, once Dodd-Frank came about after the housing crisis, we had a lot of regulations and rules pop in that we have to be aware of whenever we are doing an owner-financed property, because we're providing a mortgage for somebody at this point in time. And you do have to abide by certain rules when that happens, and part of that is running your buyer through an RMLO. By doing that, it's going to provide for you, the investor, all of the financial information on that buyer. It's going to see what their credit score is, if they've got one, all that kind of stuff. Look at their finances, look at their taxes, make sure that they can afford the property. Ability to repay, that's the buzzword that Dodd-Frank uses. You'll see it abbreviated as ATR, ability to repay. That's what we're looking for. And ultimately, what we want is something called a QM, a qualified mortgage, okay? So again, I want you to watch the Dodd-Frank series so you can really understand, the compliance series so you can really understand the Dodd-Frank and all the things that go along to doing a compliant loan. What I'll tell you right now is don't be intimidated. It's actually really easy. It's actually really easy to have a compliant loan, but there is a lot of stuff that you need to be aware of. Now, the cool thing is that by using the right attorney, by using the right RMLO, pretty much literally, you don't need to know any of it. You just have to know that you've got the right people in place taking care of those things. But it is really important for you to understand why certain actions are needing to take place so that you're in a place of protection in case things did go wrong and your buyer ever did want to sue in the future. We've got to be very aware that we live in a very litigious time frame right now. People like to sue for things. Now, fortunately, I haven't had to go through a lawsuit from something like this, and a lot of it goes down to the fact that we're doing these things to start with. It really discourages those lawsuits right from the start whenever you're showing the buyer that, hey, everything is above board, we're using the attorneys, we're using a mortgage brokerage to do the processing. It makes them understand, hey, these things were done by the book. We don't have a chance to go in and sue and get something from these guys because they were doing it by the book. And that's true because we are doing it by the book. And even if they did sue, there's no way that they would win because we've got the documentation that's told to us by the laws that we need to have. So don't stress too much about it, but understand that those are things that need to happen. So watch the compliance series on that. But as we're talking about the RMLO to our buyers, we just want them to understand, hey, we're gonna figure out what our terms are right here. Once we sign our contract, we're gonna send this contract to the RMLO, and you need to go and sit down with them, and you're gonna provide them things like your taxes and your income, whether that's check stubs or a letter from your boss or whatever. They're gonna need to get certain items from you so that they can create all of the documentation that proves that you can pay for this house. But I wanna be very clear to you that I'm the one that makes the decision on whether or not we approve or deny. And I'm pretty comfortable with what I've heard. If everything that you've told me is true about the income that you make and all that kind of stuff, if that all is true, there's nothing that sticks outside of that, we're gonna be able to move forward. Don't get intimidated by the fact that you're having to go to somebody else because they don't make the decision. They're just gathering up the documentation for me to make the decision. So it's important that you discuss that with your buyer, because a lot of times buyers, when they, you know, when they're talking to you and they're doing an owner-financed deal, they're really relying on, hey, look, I know I'm not gonna be able to apply for a regular mortgage, and this is just some guy or some girl that's gonna give me a mortgage, therefore we're okay. When you throw an RMLO in, when you throw a third party in like that, they can start to think, oh gosh, I thought it was just between me and them, but now all of a sudden this other person has to approve me. So you need to stress to them, they're not approving you, I'm approving you. This is still between you and me. But because of the legalities and things like that, compliance, I need you to go through a certain steps before I can fully put you into this property. But don't worry, It's really good. And again, me to you, Grant to investor, telling you, as an investor doing an owner finance property, you can approve basically anybody. What we are is we're called a small creditor, and small creditors, you can learn more about that in the compliance side, but as a small creditor, you can really approve. We don't have a maximum DTI cap. We don't have a minimum credit score. All of these things that the big banks have to abide by, we don't have to abide by them. So it makes it really easy on us from a compliance aspect, but what we do have to have is we do have to have documentation showing that we tried to look into it. That's what we need. Our requirements, if you actually read the law on a lot of these things, like for instance, the DTI cap, we don't have a DTI cap, but we have to quote unquote consider and verify. That's what Dodd-Frank says that we have to do, okay? So in order to consider and verify, you have to have a third party verification. You know, a lot of times that's looking at tax returns or check stubs or whatever of their income. And again, the RMLO will know all of those things that you need to get done. And then by having that licensed individual put everything together for you, you can look at it and you make the decision. They could be a crap buyer to anybody else, but if you feel like there's a reason that you're comfortable with moving forward with them, you get to move forward with them, and that's okay. All right, so just stress that to your buyer, that even though they're going through that process, not a big deal, it's still you and them. Now, for that, they're typically gonna have to pay an application fee up front, might be about $350 up front. The total fee, for instance, like with Texas Pride Lending, will come out at the end, whenever the closing occurs. Now, at the time I'm filming this video, that fee is about $850. But those fees can change over time, so it's important for you to talk to your RMLO and see what do they charge for the file processing, right? So for instance, right now they pay $350 up front, and they're gonna pay $500 at the closing table. If they don't get approved, if it doesn't go to closing, they're only out that $350, okay? They don't have to come up with the rest of it. That's how things work at this point in time. So explain that process to them, because this is a very important factor in doing an owner-financed wraparound mortgage. Due on sale clause is very important, not only on the acquisition, but on the disposition. When you're selling with a wraparound mortgage, they are just as affected by the due on sale clause as the seller or as you are, and them even more so. Right? Because these are the guys that are actually living in the house. If you sell to a wraparound buyer, that person is paying a mortgage and planning to live in the property. Well, if your due on sale clause from the underlying lien gets called and you have not taken the steps that I talk about in our due on sale series to be able to prevent something bad from happening at the end of the day, it's these people that are losing their property. Because due on sale clause over here comes, if that goes through essentially the foreclosure, any subordinate lending gets wiped out. And this wraparound buyer is a subordinate lending situation. So we need to make sure that they understand that they're in a subordinate lien and that due on sale clause could eventually wipe them out. But we also need to discuss it to them in the right way to make them understand that we don't view that as a big danger, because we don't. Now watch the due on sale series, because I'm gonna give you actually a script of how to talk about due on sale clause to where I never have buyers or sellers worry about due on sale clause anymore. We're very honest about what it is. We tell them the risk of what's happening, and we also tell them the likelihood, and the way that we describe that and the order we describe things comes in to where they're comfortable. So watch the due on sale series on that. Some final points on that, just like I was kind of hitting on a second ago, make sure that they understand they're in a subordinate lien position. You know, if you're not familiar with the lien positions, go back and watch our basics video, the intro to everything here, because they talk about lien positions at that point in time. But we want to make sure that these guys understand that they're in a subordinate lien position. Now, in our advanced series, I'm going to teach you how you can use that subordinate lien position as a benefit for yourself. But for right now, all that matters on the buyer side is that they need to understand that they're in a subordinate lien. Encourage them to have their own translator. This can be really dangerous, translating between English and another language, translating between English and Spanish, for instance. I've had this happen where, you know, literally, I will have I had a buyer whose wife was translating everything to the husband, okay? And I'm sorry, I said a buyer, a seller whose wife was translating everything to the husband. Well, the wife wanted to sell the house, and so was just straight up not telling the husband a lot of the stuff that we were talking about. She was just translating it over. She didn't discuss due on sale clause. She didn't make him understand that they were gonna remain. I was buying the house subject to. She didn't make them understand that he was remaining on that mortgage. I mean, he literally called back a couple of months later, surprised that mortgage was still in his name. And it was because the wife wasn't translating correctly. But here's the thing, is that that was on the wife. That translation was on their side. Now, I bring my own translator to every meeting that I've got translation needs for. That's part of my staffing need. All of my staff is bilingual because I understand that a large number of my buyers, Spanish is their first language, and that's what they're most comfortable speaking in. So my staff in its entirety is bilingual. Now, I'm going to have them translate for me because I've built a trust and I've really harped on them to, I tell them this, and I want you to tell your translators the same thing. Translate what I say in the order I say it, nothing more and nothing less. Because a very common mistake that translators will make that are part of your staff, and I saw this happen all the time at the beginning, is that they will not be comfortable with the whole situation because they don't know the whole scenario, right? And we do. We know what needs to be talked about, when it needs to be talked about, how it needs to be talked about it. So what I would find with a lot of translators is they would want to put their own little spin on there to make the buyer feel a little bit more comfortable, make the seller feel a little bit more comfortable, right? And luckily, I knew enough Spanish where I could tell that they were doing something or saying more than I told them, saying something different than I told them, and I would stop them and I would repeat to them, tell them exactly what I'm telling you, and nothing more, nothing less. Because we need to be very clear of the dangers of what's happening and the benefits of what's happening and what the likelihood of both of those are. We need to be very clear on that. And we don't want to brush anything under the rug. And a lot of translators will want to smooth things over and make it seem like it's less of a big deal than you're making it seem because they want them to feel comfortable. And we need them to understand exactly what's going on. So what I encourage is if you're in a situation where you need translation, make sure that your buyer has somebody with them that speaks both English and that language as well. So you basically have two translators there at any time. You've got your translator and you've got their translator. That way they have the ability to say, well, this person understood both sides and they're not interjecting saying that it's being translated wrong, right? We want that checks and balances system in there. And you can even go to the step of if they provide their own translator and you don't have a translator there, what I would encourage you to do is have a sheet for them to sign, and I can provide this for you in our resources page. So if you're a member of creativecashflow.com, look for the resources there, but a document that says they're providing their own translator and they are accepting the risk of whatever that goes with, right? Just indemnifying you from any translation issues because you do want to be very aware that that can happen. Pay a buyer's agent. I'm just gonna say it right now. There's so much that goes into finding buyers. Now you can do it, but it's a really time-consuming process. And your skill is better used in acquiring properties because fewer people are able to acquire properties well. And you, by watching this whole series and having this education, you have a step up on so many other people. There's a much larger pool of people who can bring a buyer for an owner-financed deal. So leverage that. We're gonna pay about 3% for a buyer that's a buyer's agent bringing a buyer in, okay? Totally worth it because they're gonna be putting out signs, they're gonna be taking all the phone calls. And guys, when you're selling properties, you know, if you've got 4, 5, 6, 10 properties for sale at any one time, you may be getting 700, 800 calls a week coming in. Pay somebody 3% to do that. It's not worth your time. Spend your time on the things that you're good at and only you can do. So, with selling a wraparound mortgage to a buyer, the main point that you can tell here is just getting all the information out to them, making sure that everything is disseminated correctly. Even if you are paying your buyer's agent, you do want to have that moment where you're sitting down with your buyer and you're making sure that they understand everything that's going on. It's one of the reasons why I like using Texas Pride Lending. Now, obviously, I founded Texas Pride Lending. I've since sold that company, so I'm no longer a part of the company, but I know how they operate and they are able to explain what's going on with the situation because it was founded by me, an investor who started with owner financing. Our whole world was based around doing services for owner financing. The attorneys that you use are going to be very important in that. Horn and Associates is who I used to do that. At every closing, Scott or whoever's doing that closing at Horn and Associates is going to go through all of the details that matter on that transaction. But especially if you're not using them, but even if you are using them, you need to take the time to talk to your buyer and make sure that they understand, hey, you're paying this much every month. We have the option to foreclose on you. you know, you've got a 10% down payment, make sure that y'all are on the same page before you move forward, okay? It's all about information. Information is the name of the game here. So keep watching these videos here. We've got a lot of different series that are gonna be beneficial for you on this side. You do need to know about compliance. You do need to know about negotiation. You do need to know some of the tricks that you can use to better protect yourself, like using two LLCs. You can watch our double LLC video on how you can better protect yourself moving forward with an owner financed buyer. But you've got a lot of really good information in front of you. So go out there and watch these videos, and most importantly, enact what you're learning here. Don't get stuck in an analysis paralysis. Don't get stuck in a learning loop. You really want to get out there, see what's going on, and go do it, okay? Take action on this kind of stuff. So look for us on social media. Look for Propelio.com. Go to Propelio.com if you haven't signed up for their membership already. You've got some really, really, really cool stuff that you're able to do through that. And I encourage you guys to just keep being active and keep doing what you're doing here. It's really going to lead you to the position that you want to be in ultimately. So thanks for watching this video today. And until next time, keep on learning.